So thanks again for this forum. It's always exciting to be here, and I, as usual, have too much to say. But what I'm going to try and do is, you know, there's four broad themes I wanted to talk about since we're in a session on top-down governance. You know, there's ways, four broad points I want to make illustrated with like a study each is the role of technology and top-down governance in improving program delivery. I want to spend just one slide, which is something that hasn't been talked about today, which is, you know, we have seen the returns of individual interventions to improve programs, but I just want to give you a sense of how important implementation is by comparing ROI and implementation versus program outlays. Implementation monitoring I'm going to skip because Umar and Mike have talked about that a fair bit, and what I'm going to spend a little bit more time is customizing service delivery. And I really didn't intend to talk about technology and education, but Tamina kind of wanted me to, so I'll spend like a few minutes on that. This is quickly repeating some stuff I maybe mentioned 2 years ago, but it's useful to just highlight how big this problem is, of service delivery in developing countries. So we have estimates of leakage, which is the euphemistic term for money that leaves the government and never reaches the beneficiary, that range all the way from 30 to 80% across a range of government programs. And one of the most ambitious things going on around the world in terms of building state capacity to implement these programs better is India's biometric ID program that everybody now knows about. It's over a billion unique IDs. But as with all of these things, one of the things I want to talk about, and also, you know, to provide some context to something Umar said. I mean, it is true that the typical researcher and policy timeline don't align, and maybe in the panel we can talk a little bit more about how to harmonize, these tensions. But, you know, I really want to make this plug for how important research is, because I'm going to tell you one case where technology had a huge impact, another case where technology had zero impact, and without the research, we'd have no idea, okay? So in this case, right, as with many of these things, marketing is usually five steps ahead of substance, so people kept saying that this is going to be a game changer for governance, it's going to reduce corruption, reduce leakage, all that kind of stuff. But, you know, there's so many reasons for why this might not work. I mean, complex technology implementation programs, last mile cash management, authentication failures, exclusion errors. So there's many, many reasons why you might worry about whether or not this is a good thing. So even as we speak, as Aadhaar is being rolled out, you know, you've got major civil society, extremely respected voices writing extremely concerned op-eds about how this is essentially it's a bit like the voter fraud discussion in the US, right? So in general, with this delivery of public services, conservatives are worried about fraud reduction and liberals are worried about excluding genuine beneficiaries. And in the end, this is an empirical question, right? So you can sit and kind of set the filter too high or too low, and you just don't know till you go test what's happening, all right? So the context of this study, which I have mentioned the last time I was here, was the AP Smart Card program, which was used by the government of Andhra Pradesh to integrate biometric authentication into the delivery of payments in the world's largest public workfare program, which is the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. Now, I think what's worth highlighting here is not just the fact that this was a program, but that we managed to work with the government, Umar shout out, right? In partnership with the government, to randomize this rollout at the scale of 20 million people, right? So the point is that there's no way the government can do this program overnight anyway. So normally they would have just haphazardly gone and done things, over 5 years, and we would have had no idea what the impact was. And what we did here, but you know, I agree with Umar that these things work when you have a long-term embedded partnership with government, that over 5 years, we kind of invested the relationships and kind of knowing exactly what they were trying to do, built our credibility as people who are not just in this for the paper, but really in there to try and fix and improve public systems. And in return, we managed to convince them over time that their additional administrative cost of randomizing the rollout was relatively minuscule relative to what they were getting from that. Okay, so, and we should talk a bit more about this, but the point here is we managed to pull off this RCT where they randomized across 20 million people, and the results were kind of just striking, right? So what ends up happening, just to give you a sense of the importance of the research of matched administrative and survey data, right? The problem is that if you just look at the fiscal outlays, you don't know, right? So right now the government says we brought this program in, fiscal outlays went down, hey, we cut corruption. But you don't know how much of that is genuine exclusion errors, that genuine beneficiaries have been cut out. Or conversely, as happened in this case, what would happen is there was no change in the fiscal outlay. So if you just look at the administrative data, it looks like all of this program had zero impact, right? But it's only because we had the matched survey between the household surveys and the administrative data that you can compare the leakage between treatment and control and document that you get these stunning impacts in terms of a 35%, 40% reduction in leakage in NREGS, about 50% in the pension program, and a sharp improvement in the payment process, okay? Now, Why is then, again, the evidence important? And this goes back to, I think, the question I had for Umar and Tiago and all these guys is, in some ways, the technology is easy, right? I mean, what is difficult is the political economy of, like, I mean, how do you take the technology to go and cut corruption? Because the middlemen, like, I mean, who are making the money are typically part of a political food chain, like, I mean, where the money is being passed, like, I mean, through a complex system of patronage, right? So the real question is, the empire is going to strike back, okay? Like, I mean, and the empire will strike back in ways that you don't quite anticipate. And usually what happens with these programs is the empire strikes back by hiding behind genuine beneficiaries, okay? So what will happen, and what was amazing is we had this user satisfaction data of over 90% of beneficiaries preferring the new system. But the data that was feeding into the political system was overwhelmingly negative, right? Like, I mean, and that's because you will, in a country of 1 billion people, always have a few cases where things went wrong. Like, I mean, and those were the cases that the media is going to pick up. Those were the cases that the activists will go and say, oh, here is this old pensioner who was denied his payments, how can this heartless government be insisting on biometric authentication to make payments to 75-year-old pensioners, right? So, and that's the sense in which the objective large-scale representative data, like, really, really helps to move that policy conversation. And I remember the principal secretary, like when we started the project, we signed an MOU with one guy. The next guy then, as usual, people get transferred. And the next guy came in and said, you know, who are these guys? Why are they randomizing? Why are they telling me where to go first and not? Like, I mean, let's get rid of this. So it took us like 3 months of continued work to get the study back on track. But at the end, like, I mean, he became like the single biggest fan of all of this, because when the chief minister was getting negative feedback, he would take the study and say, sir, please, like, you know, allow us to go ahead and do this. So I think that's been a really important kind of lesson for us, like going into these studies, is to be unapologetically motivated by the policy and identify all the positives, all the negatives ex ante, and be completely objective about measuring all of this, like, I mean, so that, you know, you can just be objective academics and share those results. So, well, I want to spend one slide on this point on ROI and program versus implementation. And, you know, we've talked a little bit today about interventions that reduce leakage, but there's kind of two stunning statistics I just want you to keep in your mind, which is we now have evidence from multiple settings that if what you care about is the effective program implementation, right, what is the extent to which a program exists on the ground, the ROI on better implementation is often way, way higher than the ROI on spending more on the same program. Okay, so the specific example here is AP smart cards, right? So the reduction in leakage was about 9 times the additional spending on the program. That happened at no increase in fiscal outlay. Now, what is even more stunning is, now this is the second paper, the general equilibrium paper, is that when you improve the performance of NREGS, you get another 9-fold increase, like in the private labor market income, because you're effectively increasing the minimum wage, okay? So the point was that this was an intervention in terms of income effect for the poor, had an 80x impact, like relative to the cost of expenditure. Now, the second 9x is a function of NREGS, but that's kind of how big it is. Now, what is interesting is there was another paper that Paul and Sandeep did based on like a policy reform in 2008 that increased the statutory wage paid under NREGS by over 20% and increased the fiscal outlay by 20%. But what they found was there was zero pass-through, like, I mean, of that fiscal increase, like, I mean, to the beneficiaries, because if you're in a setting of weak implementation, what matters is the outside option and not what's appropriate, right? So, and this is really important politically, because the government often gets flack from activists, like, I mean, for not raising the fiscal outlay, because that's what is more visible rather than the implementation quality and what shows up. Like, I mean, but the return on implementation is kind of incredibly high in settings like this. And going back to teacher absence, which, you know, probably my first and best known set of studies. But, you know, one of the things we do in this 2010 paper is we just quantified the fiscal cost of teacher absence. Just one line item was about $1.5 billion a year. And now if what you care about is effective class size, so why do you hire more teachers? Because you want to reduce class size. But the class size you care about is effective class size, which is the teacher actually there, right? I mean, and so what we calculate is that it's about, again, a 10 times ROI to, like, I mean, improve effective class size by improving governance and reducing absence relative to hiring more teachers, okay? So, and that's just a calculation based on administrative supervision, and if you do the kind of stuff Mike is doing in Pakistan, like, I mean, the ROI is going to be even higher. So I just want to say that implementation really, really matters, like, I mean, and while it's less cool for politicians, like, I mean, it's kind of useful to have this kind of data to share about why implementation quality matters. I'm going to skip this point about using technology for implementation monitoring. It's been talked about. We're starting to do some of this in India. And then the last part I want to talk about, which is kind of newest, some of the newest work we're doing, is basically, here's the context, okay? The context is, So what we're doing with the biometrics and the bank accounts is we have this five-year research program with Paul, Sandeep, and me, funded by the Gates Foundation over 5 years, is to really redesign the design and delivery of the Indian welfare state, right? Like, I mean, so it's about both implementing programs more effectively and expanding the feasible set of how you can do anti-poverty programming, okay? So the specific example here is just cash versus kind. The oldest question in kind of public economics is, like, how do you do, say, food security, right? Like, I mean, so the way the government of India right now does food security for the poor is subsidize food through the PDS. But this violates all the basic rules of Econ 101 because you're running a dual price system and you have massive leakage and diversion into the open market. Okay, so now all economists would say this is public finance 101, do cash. But as you can imagine, right, like, I mean, while it's promising, there's also many, many concerns, okay? So the cash may be implemented poorly, there's behavioral concerns, and one of the really tricky problems with cash transfers, once you think hard about this, is you realize that getting the spatial indexation right is incredibly hard. So when the government provides a benefit in kind, you're implicitly promising the same unit of output regardless of the cost of provision. In government accounts, it's impossible to actually figure out the spatial heterogeneity in the cost of provision once you think about transport and all of that kind of stuff. Okay, so it's a very complex problem. So what we're doing is basically, you know, it's an empirical question, but it's not just enough to run an RCT of cash versus kind when you have so much heterogeneity, okay? And this is kind of where I think the economics is easy, but some of the most important work for the economists to do is to think through the politics and de-risk the process of policy experimentation so that you have a Pareto improving deal from the very beginning as opposed to people being worse off, okay? So in this case, what we're doing is we just have a very simple idea of a choice-based approach, like, I mean, which is the default is kind, okay? We know the leakage is 50 to 70%. So in theory, a lot of people will be better off just opting for cash if you give them the same fiscal amount. But if there's spatial and temporal heterogeneity, the way you de-risk that is just give people the option of exchanging their in-kind entitlement for cash. You randomize that. And so now what you're getting is you're getting beneficiary preferences and getting an issue-level voter feedback. So that completely insulates the politician from political risk of reform. Because nobody can be worse off, right? Like, so you can always keep your default entitlement, but you can switch to cash. But the academic side of this is every research question here that we're answering is a first-order policy question, right? Which is, what are the beneficiary preferences? What is the impact of nutrition, which is going to come from the randomization? And then the coolest part is we're going to get to vary the prices that we offer, right? Like, I mean, for the cash out. And so that allows us to get it like a holy grail of public finance, which is how do you estimate the private valuation of publicly provided benefits in kind, which we've never seen any kind of example. Now, what's important here is we've had this proposal in place for 5 years. We've done like variants of this in pilots, but to do this at scale, the technology is critical. Okay, and so why is the technology critical? Because you need the back end to prevent double dipping. So right now we have this archaic coupon-based pilot, but now we're going to start this project in AP starting in a few months, where the government now has completely Aadhaar-enabled, so it's biometric with a bank account. So the back end knows whether you've availed your benefit in a given month in cash or kind and can switch off the other one. We can change the prices and we can send text messages like you mean to update people on what prices are being offered in a given month. And then it's just reveal preference, right? Like, I mean, so you get the spatial and temporal heterogeneity of how people exchange stuff. Okay, so this is one of the projects I'm most excited about. And because I think it kind of gets to top-down technology to actually improve governance at a customized level as opposed to trying to figure out policy uniformly for a whole country. Okay. Now, that says 2 minutes, but Tamina gave me three more to do computer-aided learning. Okay. So, right. And so anyway, yeah, so I think, so just switching to a topic that was not on the governance platform, but I think is really useful to kind of highlight the caution in technology and highlight, like, you know, why we need the research, is the holy grail in technology, of course, like, I mean, is everybody thinks that edtech is what's going to solve our big problems in education. There's many, many theoretical reasons for why we think this should improve education, okay? So everything from cost-effective access to high-quality instruction to supplementing instruction at home, customized learning path for students, shortening feedback loops, sounds great in theory till you go look at the evidence where the modal study finds exactly zero impact. Okay, so we've got perhaps the most stunning one of this is the one laptop per child, RCT in Peru. Like, the computer to child ratio was increased from 0.12 to 1.18. Okay, so every kid got a laptop and you get a big fat zero. Okay, we've got studies in Romania providing free computers to teenagers and you get negative impacts on learning. Of course, they're playing games. Okay, so, I mean, ex post, it's obvious. But that's not the policy conversation. Like, India's national ICT policy for education is essentially a completely hardware-focused policy, right? Like, I mean, do the schools have computer labs? So the point is that the design details really, really matter, and it's not enough just to say what's the technology doing, but it's to identify the extent to which the technology is alleviating a binding constraint in the problem that you're trying to solve, okay? So now, what we have here is probably the set of studies I'm most excited about right now, which is, you know, we've got this MindSpark Cal program that was designed over 15 years by one of India's leading edtech companies. And what's important is these were not like technologists who came to education thinking they were going to fix it, but they were educationists who came to technology to say, how do we use technology to improve the productivity of individual parts, like, I mean, of instruction, including customizing instruction paths, analyzing errors, error patterns, and doing differentiated instruction. So the main thing I want to leave you with, because we get these enormous impacts, bigger than anything I've seen. So just for perspective, you know, the effect sizes we're getting are comparable to what I've found with, say, individual performance pay over 5 years. We get the same thing in under 5 months, okay? So it's about 10 times more effective than the most effective thing I have seen. Now, why are we getting these big effects? And I think this is where the customization piece comes in, okay? So this by itself is an enormously, like, exciting picture for me. Like, in 15 years of education research, I fantasize about being able to do something like this, and it's the first time I've seen this, and that's because the computer lets us calibrate the level of learning of every single kid in a classroom. Okay, so what you're seeing here is basically on that blue line is where the kids would be if they were making grade appropriate progress. Like, so this is it's a middle school intervention. So you've got kids enrolled in grade 6, 7, 8, 9, and that blue line is where they would be if they were at a grade appropriate level. So there's three highlights here. First is by sixth grade, the average kid is already 2.5 grade levels behind. Okay, like, I mean, what the syllabus is. That gap grows over time. So by the time they get to grade 9, the average kid is 4.5 grade levels behind. And most importantly, just look at that variation, okay? So every dot on that plot is one kid. So you've got kids sitting in an eighth grade classroom in Delhi who span in levels from being at second grade level up to eighth grade level. So, you know, I don't care how much you incentivize the teacher, how well you're trained, how motivated you are, there's no way you can humanly handle that kind of variation, like it means sitting in a classroom, okay? So, and the reason I think we get these huge effects is this is now what the software is doing, because the software is calibrating where every single kid is and customizing content to you at the level of the child and being able to customize both the level and the trajectory for every single kid. And this is going to be particularly important in developing country settings, because essentially those of us who've looked at this hard are now convinced that the single biggest reason why most of your input interventions seem to have zero impact is it's because it's not alleviating the binding constraint. Like, so if you go back and look at this picture, right? Again, it doesn't matter how good you are as a teacher. Abhi dekho, agar is lecture ke beech mein main Hindi mein baat karne laga, to main bada qualified teacher hoon, bahut motivated hoon, absent nahi hoon, padhata hoon, eye contact karta hoon, sare achhe teaching practices karta hoon. Kuch samajh mein aa raha hai? बिल्कुल नहीं. तो अभी क्या हो रहा है, इस क्लास में लगभग 20% बच्चों को समझ में आ रहा है कि क्या हो रहा है. तो इस लेक्चर के बीच में आपको थोड़ा महसूस हो रहा है कि एक दिन इंडियन क्लासरूम में बच्चे को क्या फीलिंग होता है. So you have just spent 30 seconds in the shoes of an Indian kid, of a typical kid in a developing country classroom. Right? Which is, it doesn't matter how qualified the teacher is, it doesn't matter what inputs you have, it doesn't matter how motivated you are. If you're 5 grade levels behind, what you might be hearing might just as well be Greek. Okay? Now, the question is, identifying the problem is one thing. What do you do about this? And the only way, like, I mean, I see to kind of humanly have a solution that's able to scale is to do something like this and using technology to customize learning. So where we are, yeah, and so what's cool about the technology is you can see that the gains are similar for every kid at every part of the distribution, so the absolute treatment effects are constant. But going back to the Hindi lecture, what this is showing you the value add by terciles of baseline scores. And so those red bars show you that kids at the bottom tercile basically learn nothing, right? Like, I mean, by spending time in school, which is consistent with what I just told you, that if you're that far behind where the textbooks and the instruction are, it doesn't matter what's going on, you're not learning, okay? So the promise of technology, particularly, like, I mean, for the kids who are falling far behind, is enormous. But what we have so far is just an efficacy trial. So we're now going to the field with something that's going to be done with about 10,000 kids, 50 government schools embedded in government, but watch the space, right? So that's what's happening.